And joining us this morning on Hot Copy, we have Senate Finance Committee Chairman Sonny Angara. He is also one of the senators asking for an audit on government spending on COVID-19 response. Good morning to you, Senator Sonny.
Morning, Karen. Good morning to the viewers.
All right. You just heard the report that just right before the interview. Why is the Senate, why did the Senate pass Bayanihan 2 at 140 billion pesos, given that the House passed a 1.3 trillion peso stimulus package? Most of you admit that 140 billion pesos is not enough to revive the economy. Why pass that in the first place, Senator?
Karen, yung sa amin, it's Bayanihan 2. What they pass is ARISE. Their version of Bayanihan 2 is about 162 billion, if I'm not mistaken. So pag tiningnan mo, 162, 140, hindi naman nagkakalayo. And what the DOF, in our discussions with the Department of Finance and the other economic managers, the agreement was that we can pass this Bayanihan 2 as a mini stimulus. Mm-mm. And if the situation calls for it and if the situation improves, because note that we passed Bayanihan 2 before the BIR deadline for paying taxes.
Yes.
So we didn't have an idea of how much our collections would be. No, so now we probably have a better idea of that. And we can see going forward if we can pass other stimulus like the ARISE bill passed by the House of Representatives, Karen.
Okay. Now, given that you have the lower house and the Senate already passing their own versions of Bayanihan 2, when you meet in the BICAM, Senator Mig Zubiri said that he is personally, he believes that it's possible to increase it to 500 billion pesos. What about you, Senator? Are you seeing a middle ground in terms of a figure?
500 billion, I think. I doubt the economic managers would agree to that. Mm. And they really asked us to keep it realistic because otherwise you'd be raising expectations of people and there'd be no money to finance it. So sabi nila, mangyayari niyan is you could either have a veto or you could have an unfunded mandate, which would be a shame. If you raised expectations, you made promises. I think we need to be realistic in our expectations somehow.
Okay. So do you believe, Senator Sonny, that it will stay at 140?
Well, thereabouts. Hindi lalayo. I doubt it will go over 200, to be honest.
Okay. What were the amendments that were put in the Senate version?
Marami. Because it's really a collegial effort. So you're talking about the inclusion, for instance, of smart campuses. Senator Joel put that in. Assistance to the private educational sector, Senator Gatchalian put that in. Amendments for testing to reach certain metrics, to test a certain percentage of the population, especially in areas where the virus tends to spread, like urban areas and capitals. Senator Gordon, Senator Pia also had some inputs on that. So agriculture, Senator Aimee had a lot of inputs. So you know, it's really a cobbled together. That's the beauty of legislation, Karen. It's a collegial effort.
Okay. But then, Senator Angara, would 140 billion pesos frankly address all the amendments that were put in the Senate version of Bayanihan 2? Or frankly speaking, you're seeing that part of the 2021 budget would be used for some of the needs in a post-COVID response already?
Well, Bayanihan 2 is for 2020, no? Mm. It's meant to be spent for the rest of the year. Whereas 2021 budget, both will address the needs raised by COVID because our hospitals will be put under greater pressure, our health system will be tested. So definitely, all of those will be addressed by both pieces of legislation, Karen.
Okay. So, Senator Angara, I just want to ask you this because Congresswoman Stella Kimbo had a press conference the other day, and she said clearly the elephant in the room during the president's sauna was on ARISE. She said that several aspects of the president's speech were actually all about ARISE. And she said that kung icha chop chop ang ARISE, and it's served in a piecemeal approach. and then it is implemented as regular budget items and proposed interventions when it comes to, you know, in times of need, it won't be as effective in terms of the response. Breaking it down, the proposed interventions, she said, will just appear like regular budget items. Considering that the budget comes from the lower house, if the lower house essentially passed a 1.3 trillion stimulus package, why would the Senate not trust the lower house in this aspect, Senator Angara?
It's not a matter of trusting. No? It's a matter of what is doable, Karen. And I have great confidence in the abilities of Congresswoman Stella Kimbo. And to give credit to her, she was the first legislator, whether congresswoman or senator, to file a stimulus. And in fact, I filed her version initially, which was filed in March. I filed that in the Senate and I asked her permission if I could file it. And we've been talking to her about it. So if you look at the items in the Arise and the Bayanihan 2, a lot are very similar. You have chapters on transportation, tourism, yeah, agriculture, mention of education, mention of the creative sector, mention of certain hard-hit economic actors, no? Mm-hmm. So, but a note also, I think not many people know, the 1.3 trillion in Arise is spread over 3 years. Mm-hmm. So I think the gap between the two pieces of legislation may be exaggerated.
But that's still a big gap, don't you think, Senator? Because 1.3 trillion...
You're talking about 400, and then you're talking about 140. It is a big gap, yes, but it's not 1.3 trillion versus 140 in 1 year. That's what I'm saying.
Okay, what you're telling me is, first of all, during the BICAM, you don't think that there would be an adjustment that's above 200 billion. You're sure about that?
I think realistically, because the premise is that this will be the first piece of stimulus for the, but not the only. So that's mm-hmm. That's the premise that we're coming from, Karen, no?
Okay. And how far do you think will the stimulus package go, frankly?
How far will it go?
Yeah, because
it is better, definitely better than no package. And it addresses, I think, some of the most urgent and most affected sectors. Karen, if you're talking about health problems in the economy, if you're talking about affected sectors, for instance, the tourism sector, which was closed for 3 months of ECQ or quarantine, no? So the transportation sector, that's greatly affected. The private educational institutions, the private schools, mm-mm, which were already reeling from previous legislation like the free college, mm-mm, they were really hit. Their enrollment was really cut when we passed laws like the free college or free tertiary education.
Okay.
And previous to that, the K-12, their enrollment really dwindled. And yeah, this is really, could be the death blow for many private schools, no? So we're conscious about that and we want to help them out. And in terms of credit assistance, we're putting at least 50 billion there in land bank, DBP, fill guarantee.
And so that's the 140 billion?
Yes, of the 140 billion, there's 50 billion meant for MSMEs. That was mentioned by the president in his SONA.
And it's going to land bank.
If you look at it, those who have, they're the most vulnerable types of economic enterprises because they're probably living on loans and they're probably living week to week or month to month, Karen.
Okay. So can you give me right now the division before we move to another topic? Of the 140 billion of the Senate version, 50 billion clearly, that's close to one third, is going to the land bank for MSME, Senator. And the rest is, how is it divided?
Yeah, the 50 you mentioned, it's not just land bank, it's also DBP and fill guarantee. And we'll probably put in the BICAM something for the SB Corp, the Small Business Corp of DTI. Then you're talking about 32 billion worth of cash for work and unemployment assistance. Mm-hmm. This is for, and for continuation of the SAP or the Social Amelioration Program. Mm-hmm. This is for those who lost their jobs. Mm-hmm. And it's also for returning OFWs, mm-hmm, as well as affected citizens in the formal and informal sector.
Okay.
And then you have 17 billion each for the transportation and the agricultural sector. Then you have 10 billion for the tourism sector. Then you have 4 billion for the smart campuses and for Tesla trainings, Karen.
Mm-mm-mm. Okay. I'm sorry, how much you mentioned for smart campuses, Senator?
There's 4 billion there for smart campuses and Tesla training, Karen.
How much?
4 billion.
$4 billion. Okay. How was this division made? I'm curious, Senator, was there a study on it? Or essentially,
there were figures
these
given by NEDA. NEDA made a presentation to us in the course of the deliberations. And because it's a moving target, Karen, you know, you're talking about week to week. They made a presentation during the committee hearing, and then they also made a presentation or written comments during the course of the plenary deliberations.
Okay. Senator, how long do you think will the $32 billion for the cash for work go, given that in the first Bayanihan, $200 billion was set aside for social amelioration? Well, I think it was for 18 million families. But as we know, that wasn't enough even. So when it comes to this, considering I think there are 6 million OFWs estimated to return to the Philippines, plus you have so many other individuals who have lost their jobs. Did they give you a number on just how many that they estimate the $32 billion will be able to address?
I think there's a figure, but I just don't recall it up to now. But I think you're comparing Bayanihan one figure, Karen. But I think what you have to remember is the context is somewhat different, because in Bayanihan one, the whole Philippines was on lockdown and on extended community quarantine. Whereas when we were debating Bayanihan two, most of the Philippines was already under GCQ and moving towards GCQ. And I think at that time, only Cebu City was really under ECQ. So the budgetary requirements would shift somewhat, and the felt needs would shift also somewhat.
Mm-mm. Okay. Now, in terms of auditing how Bayanihan 1 was spent, you were one, I think, of six senators that had already asked for an audit. And until today, even the Department of Health has not given a detailed expense sheet, so to speak, on how they spent $75 billion, more or less, during the COVID response.
Yes, I think that's the resolution of Senator Risa. She texted me if I support it. I said, yes, I support the call for a special audit, because I'm the chairman of finance, so we spend it and we want it spent in a responsible manner. Hindi naman instant dapat rin naman yung results. We're not asking tomorrow you give us a special audit. We're asking the COA to do a special audit, which is a little more detailed than their regular audit, because a lot of discretion was given to officials, and you know, when there's discretion and sometimes there's a lack of accountability, it might lead to corruption. We're not saying there was corruption, but we just want kind of people to be on their guard when they spend. They don't overprice things. And Senator Lacson made a good amendment also during the Bayanihan 2 because of the Bayanihan 1, which required or which relaxed the Government Procurement Act. We put in a provision on procurement that, number one, there should as much effort to be procuring from local manufacturers as much as possible, as long as the price is competitive with imported goods. And secondly, that procurement must be made in an efficient, expeditious, and cost-efficient manner, Karen. No? That's the change made from the procurement provision in Bayanihan 1.
Okay. Now, Malacanang has said that the Filipino can expect a more invigorated response when it comes to the government's action on COVID response. During the president's sona, what struck you the most, or were you able to hear a comprehensive plan coming from the government on fighting COVID and also how to revive the economy? What was your take on the president's speech?
Well, the president, I think every son is quite comprehensive because it touches on a lot of subjects. But, well, I note the comments also of some people that they expected a more detailed approach to combating COVID. And I think, but if you look at the president, he's more of a delegating type of leader. So I didn't really expect, he's not, unlike someone like President GMA, for instance, who's really goes into each detail being an economist. So I guess you have to look at the approach also, the leadership style of each chief executive, no? And I think a lot of people were surprised that he didn't really mention PhilHealth, given that PhilHealth has been in the news lately with the resignation of some of its key officers.
Okay. And how do you think Malacanang should address PhilHealth, given that a whistleblower has come out and accused the chief of PhilHealth, who's been recently appointed by the president to clean up corruption in PhilHealth? He's being accused now of being the head of the new syndicate in PhilHealth.
Yes, I think they've called for an investigation, as has the Senate. In fact, the Senate the other day convened the committee into a committee of the whole, Karen, so that all the senators could participate. And given the importance of the subject matter, especially so crucial to our nation, given that so many people will be needing health insurance in the coming months and years, Karen.
No.
And given that the budgetary allocation for PhilHealth has really ballooned in the last decade.
Okay, Senator, what would you like to see in terms of the invigorated COVID response as described by Malacanang?
For health, I think we're on the right track in terms of trying to increase our testing, although talagang there are a lot of challenges, especially in given the geography of the Philippines. It's hard to really have testing centers in each province, but that should be the goal. I think not just with the Bayanihan, not just with the 2020 interventions, but even in the coming years, no, Karen? So we saw kasi when COVID hit the Philippines, it was so, the reaction was so Manila-centric and it was so urban, urban-centric. No? So we want that to change going forward. And of course, I think we need improved contact tracing, real-time contact tracing, kasi mabagal pa rin. So when they mentioned that they want the results to be faster from 72 hours to 48 hours, I think we should even try to go faster than that ideally, because that window is also the time you have to trace the contacts, and that's how you limit community transmission. So yung real-time element is very crucial, Karen, no? And that's the health component. We should be testing, we should be tracing, we should be quarantining, isolating in a better manner. And of course, the Rizal Sports Center incident shows that we have to also be conscious about distancing. Even the government itself, which is asking people to distance, has had difficulty following its own protocols. So we should be conscious about that going forward. And of course, on the economic side naman, I appreciated what the president said on the digital landscape and kind of telling the telcos to shape up. That's important, and I think that's where our future really lies in terms of job creation, because I don't think you'll be seeing many factories being put up in the next 2 years, but as long as we have the digital infrastructure in place, we have a lot of skilled workers who can benefit or thrive in that type of environment.
Okay.
So we're really hopeful that those types of transactions can be, and businesses and industries can be fast-tracked, Karen. And we also appreciate the mention of
Senator,
e-government or online transactions. I think that's going to be crucial in limiting, in helping and the public convenience and really making things convenient for our countrymen. We should have done it before, actually, already, but now we have no choice.
Yeah, Senator, I don't mean to interrupt you or cut you there, but I'll go back to the telcos later on. But let's just stick to health for a while. You were the first senator, and then many followed, asking for the resignation of Health Secretary Francisco Duque. You've actually said that many of you have hit his supposed incompetence, and the president has stood by him. Have you seen improvements in his performance?
There have been improvements in the administration's response. I don't know if that can be credited to Secretary Duque, because I think many of the improvements were when they put in General Galvez and Secretary Vince Dizon in charge. And I'm hoping there will be improvements in contact tracing now that Mayor Benji Magalong is on board as part of the team. No.
Okay. Before we move, no. Right now, the Philippines has overtaken China. Philippines is now at 85,486. We've already breached the 85,000 mark, as predicted by the University of the Philippines. There are talks that Manila, Metro Manila, may go back to MECQ. Actually, there are fears. What will it cost us, Senator Angara, if Metro Manila goes back to MECQ? We are already actually the longest lockdown in the world.
The economy will probably collapse, Karen, if we go back to MECQ. And we're just postponing the inevitable because that type of approach, it's not really the model approach. The model approach is trying to live with COVID, not trying to avoid COVID. I think the lockdown approach is trying to avoid it and you're trying to postpone the inevitable. Parang sabihin mo, o sige, next week na lang natin gawin yan. But really, at some point in time, you have to face it. And you have to learn how to live with the virus. You have to increase your testing, whether you're a private company or you're the government. You have to periodically test your people so that because the virus is it's alive and thriving. So what your test is 2 days ago, it could be completely different in 24 hours.